what is it you're contracting to do when you're contracting to work for an employer? And I think this is where it gets really intense, the kind of domination. Because if you, I don't know if either of you have employers, but if you think about, I mean, I know you do, but you may not have a kind of more, where you're going every day to work. But
could you tell how we look? We're men of vast wealth. We're landed aristocracy. We're essentially we're the gentry, really. I'm glad you could tell by looking at us.
It's very apparent.
Welcome back to Left Anchor. I'm Alexi the Greek.
And I'm Ryan Cooper. Today we've got a special guest, Corey Robin, who is associate professor of political science at Brooklyn College and CUNY, if I'm not mistaken, and author of The Reactionary Mind, which is a history of conservatism that's very good, and also author of the upcoming biography of Clarence Thomas, which is called, if I'm not mistaken, The Enigma of Clarence Thomas. And when is that coming out, Corey?
September 24th or September 26th, one of those 2 days.
Yeah.
But I imagine you can probably pre-order it now if you like, though.
Yes, you can definitely pre-order it now.
Yeah, and I think it's going to be a humdinger. So, if you're interested in, conservative jurisprudence and ideology, I think this is definitely worth picking up. Take that in mind. Alexi, do you want to start us off here with the freedom question?
Sure. Yeah. If it's okay with you, Corey, I figure we might start with a discussion of freedom, and then that might make for a good transition to the book on Clarence Thomas, if that works.
That sounds great.
Wonderful. So I was really enjoying some of the things you sent and keeping track of the importance of defining for these leftist movements and these rising stars that we have with AOC and Rashid Tlaib and the DSA, the importance of theory and theoretical frameworks to ground political action. So, I noticed in your writing on Reclaiming the Politics of Freedom that part of why it's so important for the left to realize this is because of the success of the right, of conservatism, has maybe been misunderstood. And you suggest that perhaps their success is grounded in their taking claim of the philosophical terrain on the point of freedom or the concept of freedom. And it's a moral political battle and a moral ideological battle that the left needs to engage in. And perhaps we need to be more conscious about doing so. So maybe you can lay out a little bit of why this is important to the political work that needs to be done. And then from there, we might proceed into fleshing out why freedom over equality and so forth might be a good underpinning for the left, theoretically.
Yeah, so I wrote that piece, Reclaiming the Politics of Freedom, back in, I think it was 2011. It was actually a talk that I'd given in 2010. So remember, this is at the height of the Tea Party. And Obama was still president, and I bring that up because to say that today to say that the right's moral claim or that the right stands for freedom can sound odd in the era of Trump, and there's a good reason why it sounds odd. but I do think it's important that that at least one big part of the modern conservative movement, as a wide variety of historians have shown, really laid claim to the mantle of freedom and claimed in all sorts of ways that they were the true defenders of freedom and that the real threat to freedom was from the left. I just more recently did a piece on Hayek in the Boston Review, and I went back, and it's just really striking in his pieces in the 1930s and the 1940s. This is Friedrich von Hayek, the economist and philosopher. It's just striking how much he thinks that the conservative argument or the free market argument against the left is not a technical argument. And remember, he's quite an accomplished technical economist. It's not a technical argument. It's not an efficiency argument. It's not about capitalism can deliver the more goods for than other systems can. It's really, he thinks, fundamentally a moral and a cultural argument, and it comes down to the question of freedom. And the other part of it is how much he thinks, and how dangerous this is, but how much he thinks that the left has capitalized and controlled the discourse of freedom, and that he wants the right to wrench it back for itself. And, you know, and that really was a big part of the context of the right wing ascendancy throughout the 20th century.
Right. And that, so that's the reactionary move that Hayek makes on behalf of the right to reclaim freedom. After, I think you wrote that he saw the victory of the economic argument already having been won over the central planners and so forth. And so he saw the need to move to claim the victory morally as well, right?
Yeah, exactly. And again, and freedom really was a big part of the argument, the moral argument that he thought had to be won. And so that, you know, it is a long-winded way of saying back in 2010, you heard a lot of this kind of freedom talk from the Tea Party. And the other part of that article that I wrote was that I've always felt this about the left, that it has never taken the right's arguments seriously. It's always a large part of the left, you know, has been completely uninterested in the right's arguments. That's changed a bit, I think, with Trump. They felt that the right doesn't have any arguments, and they felt that the beginning and the end of the right wing political agenda has rested, you know, on kind of emotional appeals of various sorts. During the aughts, that was thought to be, you know, fear and security talk, that terrorism was the big thing. And, you know, now more recently, it's thought to be a kind of racial animus, again, devoid of any sort of political arguments and content. So that's the other context for that article, is to say, you know, the right does have certain arguments. And one of them in their arsenal has been freedom. And just one last quick thing is where I was coming from in that article and still believe is that in the United States in particular, freedom has always been, you know, probably the leading political vernacular. And Eric Foner, the historian at Columbia, has a great book called The Story of American Freedom. And, you know, one of the basic arguments of that book is whoever controls freedom talk controls political discourse. Mm-hmm. There's a broad backdrop to this thing. And that was really what was driving that argument, which I think was the first time I really made it about why the left needs to take freedom seriously and reclaim freedom for what was historically a left political principle.
Yeah. And so, like, moving forward a year, you have this great post co-written with some other folks on Crooked Timber. It's called Let It Bleed, and it's kind of a takedown of the bleeding heart libertarians. And I would, you know, most of it is about what I might characterize as the dictatorship of work. The fact that most people in their workplace, they have no freedom, they have no democracy, they have no influence over their conditions of labor. And so maybe you could go through that argument, trying to say that, you know, here's in a very concrete sense, here is a way in which the left agenda is freedom expanding.
Yeah. So this was an article or a blog post, but it was like 6,000 words long. it was pretty epic, that I wrote with Alex Gurevich, who is a political theorist at Brown, and Chris Bertram, who's a political philosopher in Britain at Bristol. And, you know, the main thrust of that article was to really try to challenge libertarian arguments about freedom by focusing on the workplace. You know, the workplace is, Marx talks about this quite a bit, the way it's the sort of hidden abode of capitalism. When people think about capitalism, they oftentimes think of the market, the free market. And, you know, the other half of capitalism, as Marx says in chapter 14 of Capital, you know, there's the freedom in the market, and then there's despotism in the workshop. And we felt that this is, you know, the workplace is just something that is this kind of black box, certainly for libertarians who hardly ever talk about it, but also more generally, I think, among the media and liberal intellectuals. It's striking how much of that has changed in the last 6 or 7 years. But, you know, when we wrote that piece and prior to that, when I was blogging, you know, I was constantly trying to, you know, bring up the workplace And the idea behind that is that the workplace is really a sphere of what the philosopher Elizabeth Anderson calls private government. It is a sphere of autocracy. I mean, and private government, frankly, is a kind of a gentle way of putting it. What it really is a sphere of autocracy. And in this article, we go through all the different things that you can and cannot do at work, almost entirely dependent upon the will and caprice of your employer or of his or her minions. And, you know, one of the most striking, and I could go through so many examples, but I think one of the most striking ones is something that I first learned from Barbara Ehrenreich's book, Nickel and Dimed, which is about the right to pee on the job, which is this, you know, I don't quite know how to describe it, you know, this incredibly brutal contest that has gone on in the American workplace because American workers don't have the basic right to urinate at work. And so what oftentimes happens, particularly in low wage kind of work where there are particularly for women of color, is that they end up using adult diapers because they literally just cannot get off wherever, you know, we have this image of an assembly line. It's probably a little bit out of date, but whatever the work is, you can't leave the work site, the site where the work is happening, just to relieve yourself. And it's incredibly monitored as well by employers who keep track with all kinds of and this, by the way, is not some kind of old school holdover from the past. There's all kinds of high tech surveillance mechanisms. You know, hotel maids, for instance, housekeepers in hotels are subject to this kind of surveillance as well. So that's just one of the many basic, you know, what we take for granted. I think what people in the media in particular take for granted. That you would be able to do that's just denied to American workers. So there's the denial of rights on the job, and then but what's even more frightening is that denial of rights on the job extends off the job as well. And back in 2012, there were a bunch of articles about how employers were really monitoring and instructing how their workers were voting in the presidential election. That's just one of the many examples. People are penalized for speech and behavior they engage in off the job, not on the job. So there's that as well. So there's the way your employer controls you at work. There's the ways in which your employer can control you when you're not at work. And then there's what Ryan was bringing up, the sort of basic lack of control and the lack of voice you have to engage in protest about any of these things. And the final thing is, then I'll be quiet, is all of this is almost entirely legal. The legal protections for workers are so few in this country that, you know, unless, you know, the reasons for doing for the employer punishing you or retaliating against you have to do, say, with race or gender or one of those protected categories, if it's not to do with that, It's basically Thunderdome, and they can completely control you.
Right. And this is to your very good point about the complete inverse of the reality that the libertarians or the right generally pose freedom as, which is getting the state out of your business and presuming that freedom lies everywhere else, where the picture that you just painted is one of complete domination and control in those private spheres, those very spheres where the government is not allowed to intervene because of the dominance of the right politically. And it seems to me that in fleshing out this juxtaposition about what freedom means for the left or what it should mean for the left as against the right, non-domination seems to be key, because the right has made this kind of Hobbesian notion of freedom as pure choice, and fear and liberty are consistent. And you, as long as you choose it, it doesn't matter under what conditions that choice was made. And in this long blog post, you talked about the fact that when you when you contract, you're not just signing up to do certain things. You're alienating your will to the employer to have control over you in all the ways. And the right says, well, at least you've chosen to do that, just the same way that apparently unpaid interns choose to work for free. And so it's very important, it seems to me, theoretically, to understand that freedom isn't mere choice, absent understanding these coercive conditions, right?
Yeah, I mean, so that's a big part of it, is the conditions under which you're making the choice. But I should say, you know, that's an argument I think that the left has, you know, historically made, that if you're a poor person and you're making this choice out of desperation, it's not really a free choice. I think the argument that that we're making actually goes significantly further, because even if you were to set that aside, that whole thing, what is it you're contracting to do when you're contracting to work for an employer? And I think this is where it gets really intense, the kind of domination. Because if you know, I don't know if either of you have employers, but if you think about, I mean, I know you do, but you may not have a kind of more, you know, where you're going every day to work. But
could you tell how we look? We're men of vast wealth. We're landed aristocracy. We're essentially we're the gentry, really. I'm glad you could tell by looking at us.
It's very apparent. But yeah, I mean, what is it you're contracting to do if you're a secretary, or if you're a waiter, or, you know, if you're a teller at a bank? What is it you're contracting to do for your employer? You know, oftentimes these job descriptions are paper thin, and they're not worth the paper that they're written on, because there's very little way of enforcing them. And so that's the other part of this, is that, and this is where the Hobbesian argument, for those of you who are listening who are political theory students, you know, if you've read Leviathan, you know, what you do is you contract, you contract to submit to Leviathan. But it's, you know, that, you know, and Hobbes at least has the guts of his conviction to say, and what you're contracting to do is to submit to Leviathan's will in almost, you know, in all matters, save for one, which is, you know, your own immediate self-defense. And the kinds of contracts you have to sign to an employer can include a whole array of things that, you know, how is this part of my job? Well, it turns out your job is what your employer says is your job. You know, an employment relationship is a relationship of legal subordination to the will of another person. And so I think that really is what it comes down to. It's both the conditions of entrance, as you said, but also what are the conditions of work that you're agreeing to in the first place.
But it occurs to me that you're also doing more than just saying heteronomy is the problem, that someone else is substituting for your reasoning and your judgment, and that you're not truly autonomous. Because that could be one response that really the left needs to just support autonomy. And maybe that is the response, but it seems to me there's even more depth to what you're saying in terms of what the alternative should be, what freedom really entails.
Yeah. And so, and here I'm speaking more for myself. I mean, Alex and I are currently writing a longer piece on freedom and what it means. And I mean, at least this part we're in agreement about. But I think the other big part of what freedom does entail, but before I get there, I just want to really stress this, because, you know, I think particularly among leftists, this is an important argument to remember. You know, the liberal argument is freedom is the absence of external constraint, and that's called, you know, negative liberty. And that's, leftists have always poo-pooed this as a kind of, bourgeois sort of liberty. But even on that very minimal definition, the workplace, what's so striking is how absent that is. You know, Hobbes says, you know, freedom is the freedom of movement without external impediment. If you don't have the right to urinate, the most basic bodily motion, you can see how constrained that environment is. So it's certainly, that's one part of the freedom. But I think another big part of the freedom that both Alex and I believe in, and it's, again, something that Ryan alluded to when he talked about democracy at work, is the right to be part of a collective that will determine the conditions of your own work. You know, I think is a really central part of freedom, which is kind of democratic governance. It's something that people sort of intuitively get in the political sphere. I think increasingly understand in the private sphere. But it's not enough just to consent, you know, to the conditions of work, but to have an actual voice on the job. And, you know, historically, this is what labor unions, this has been, you know, really the central demand of what labor unions have always cared about the most. And it's also been the absolute hardest thing to get for workers. Yep. You know, employers in the end are willing to make concessions on wages and benefits, but giving up that kind of right to rule at work, the right to determine, you know, the conditions of work, has been very, very hard for unions to get and for employers to give up. But, you know, there have been some unions historically that have been able to do that. And that kind of right to have a voice on the job, to participate in setting the terms and conditions of your own work, to engage in political conflict in order to sort of find some way to supervene at work, I think is really critical. And again, a critical part of what it means to be a free human being.
Yeah, maybe just to back this out a little bit, you know, we've been talking about libertarians. A lot of it seems like the kind of libertarian moment has passed. They've either become centrist liberals or they've gone on to the harder, the racism stuff and white nationalism. But at this moment, you know, in 2012, 2013, you know, you had the classic libertarian discourse about negative liberty and you know, non-aggression principle sort of thing, that if you set up the right procedural system, or which that nobody is forced, quote unquote, to you know, sign up to anything, then you have no coercion. But the reality of any like state, you know, any like political community is that there is always coercion because there is scarcity and people disagree about, you know, who gets the resources. And what a democracy does in a way that I would say is freedom enhancing is to allocate that scarcity and that coercion in a way in which everyone gets a say in where it goes. And we agree that, you know, however, you know, the vote goes, like subject to civil liberties, constraints, and so on, that's where, you know, we will say that we, instead of just saying, like, I'm starving, I'll sign this job contract, like, I have a vote, I'm going to sign this contract. And I think similarly in the workplace, you could say, yeah, you know, you can't just work however you want, maybe, because, like, these, you know, operations are difficult and, like, you know, it takes some effort and, you know, some people are lazy, maybe they don't show up and so on. But if you have a union and you have co-determination where there are worker representatives on the board of directors, that way you can allocate the sort of coercive aspects of the work, the parts that are unpleasant. And to say that, like, well, I agree to this in a much more meaningful sense rather than just saying, like, if I don't sign on the dotted line, I'll starve. Is that, would you say, a fair description?
Yeah. And, you know, and I think it, you know, I think it's just to expand even further, it's not just, you know, to be kind of part of a democratic collective that deliberatively sort of agrees to how to distribute the shit work. which is important, though. I mean, you know, yeah. I wouldn't minimize that. But also, you know, I think there's a, you know, there's actually a kind of continuity between more sort of left-wing Marxist thinkers, including Marx, but also more liberal thinkers like John Stuart Mill, who was a kind of liberal socialist toward the, you know, toward the end, toward the sort of end of his career, about kind of the self-development that could occur when people, you know, have an opportunity to kind of increase their talents and powers and skills. You know, well, I shouldn't use the word skills because that has such a kind of George W. right, Bush, Barack right, Obama, right, right. You know, race to the top kind of.
On this podcast, we use arete, excellences, virtues in the classical sense. We can do that.
Exactly. I mean, but yeah. That's what it is. And to kind of develop that. And, you know, I just saw the other day, God, I can't remember. I think it was Matt Grossman who is on Twitter. He's a great political scientist. And, you know, one of the things it was a kind of empirical poli-sci study showing, like, that, you know, the amount of political knowledge that workers in a union have is, you know, systemically greater than the kind of knowledge, the amount of knowledge and the kind of knowledge that workers who don't have a union have. And that's just, you know, just one small example of the kind of broader education one gets, I think, through the process of collective action and collective institutions that you don't have without a union. So I think it's a whole array of kind of knowledge and self-development through collective action that I think is critically important.
Yeah. Your job's not just, you know, it's not just like performing the task in an ideal sense. You want your job to be meaningful, to be, something that you're proud of performing. And, this is, I think, the big swing against a lot of what conservatives talk about when they mention unions. You know, it's like, oh, you have a union and they're going to destroy the company. Like, the union has an interest in the company continuing to produce good products. And conversely, you know, you see a lot of executives and investors just looting these companies. And so, you know, you could imagine a world the utopian society of like Norway or Denmark or something where everyone's unionized, but they still have very successful businesses, right?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I was a graduate student at Yale in the 90s, and there was very strong unions there, both for the clerical and technical workers, but also the service and maintenance workers. And I remember the administration or management was making a move to subcontract something with the dining halls, and the unions were fighting this. And I remember the dining hall workers, the people who cook in particular, put on a kind of banquet one night. To showcase the different kinds of, you know, meals they could and would like to. And you know, these guys were like, you know, really talented workers and chefs. And, you know, Yale was systematically, you know, ignoring and kind of de-skilling is sort of a technical word. But, you know, really just making the job just a crappy job, leading to crappy food. And there were all these talents, you know, that were there. You know, Adam Smith in the beginning of The Wealth of Nations talks about, you know, all the innovations, the technological innovations that were driven by workers, oftentimes looking for more efficient ways of doing things so that they could have more leisure time on the job. But, you know, the kind of inventiveness that Smith, you know, the godfather supposedly of modern libertarianism, which is, you know, completely untrue. But, you know, the kind of talent and inventiveness and skill and vision and imagination that Smith was able to see in common workers is just something that, you know, modern libertarians, you know, hardly see at all.
Yeah.
That's right. No, yeah, we've talked about Adam Smith on this podcast before, and it's unfortunate how bad his reputation seems to be today, given the complexity of his arguments. But you know, it occurs to me that the first principles that you talk about coming back to with freedom, it's clearly not just procedural, and it's distinct from the liberal view of equity or equality as the end, where it's simply about distribution of resources. Because in a sense, you know, as the ancient Greeks would say, you need mere life before you can have the good life, and so in a sense, the ability to have the materiality that frees you up to then pursue and become human in the way you just described, with all those creative abilities and talents, and the ways that, like, the whether it's the universal basic income or the job guarantee or any number of these policies are good, not just because they eliminate starvation and all these other things, but the ways that they give the conditions for pursuing those talents and those lives that people otherwise can't pursue. Maybe that's something that the left needs to talk more about.
Absolutely. I mean, whenever I teach Marx, you know, and I talk about this in class, you know, he was a great reader of Aristotle, and was really indebted to that kind of classical idea of flourishing, human flourishing. And, you know, it's not just that these material goods enable the good life, although that's very true and important. it's also that, you know, in the deliberation, I mean, I think kind of Marx's innovation and what makes, you know, what socialism at its best really should be about is it's the politicization of the economy. And in the real sense of what that means, which is that you enable ordinary people to argue about the distribution of roles and responsibilities and goods and resources, and that you don't just leave it to the alleged impersonality of the market, but you give people a say in, you know, the conditions that make their lives. And in the process of that, you know, there's both the kind of the material distribution that gets you to the good life, but it's also in the act of distributing and the arguments about distributing is also part of what, the good life. And so I do think, you know, that's really, that's very important.
This is maybe a good spot to switch to Clarence Thomas.
Absolutely.
The Joe Biden, maybe a good jumping off point is to talk about his appointment, his confirmation hearings, rather, back in 1991, if I'm not mistaken, in which Joe Biden was the chairman of the Judiciary Committee. And, he oversaw that process. So maybe you could you walk us through what happened there with the questions about his politics and the Anita Hill accusations?
Yeah, so Clarence Thomas was nominated to the Supreme Court by George H.W. Bush after the retirement of Thurgood Marshall, who had been the first Black Supreme Court justice. And it was pretty clear that a big reason why Thomas was nominated by Bush was that he was Black. And the feeling was that, this would be a very, it'd be hard to oppose him if he was Black. And for a while, that actually proved to be true. He had support. I mean, the NAACP was very slow to oppose him. And there was a lot of division within the Black community, a lot of Jim Clyburn was actually a state senator in South Carolina at the time, was a big supporter of Clarence Thomas's. So there was a fair amount of support within the Black community. And over the summer, there was arguments about Thomas, which we can talk about or not. But it looked by the end of his, I think it was 8 days of testimony, both he gave 5 days of testimony and then there were 3 days of witnesses. It looked pretty certain that he was going to be confirmed. And it looked, in fact, that according to Jane Mayer and Jill Abramson in their book, Strange Justice, which is the best book written on this, it looked like Biden was probably going to vote to confirm as well. And so it looked like he was headed for a pretty solid vote, you know, in the upper 60s, lower 70s. And then these allegations came out from Anita Hill that he had engaged in multiple acts of sexual harassment, all of a verbal nature. And that prompted an additional set of hearings, which, you know, again, just I don't know how old you guys are, but I think you're probably younger than I am from the looks of it. But I was in graduate school. I was in my second year of graduate school. So this is all, you know, kind of fresh to me. Biden was essentially forced to convene a second set of hearings where Anita Hill gave testimony. Other people gave testimony. I mean, it got very freakish at moments with Orrin Hatch reading out passages from The Exorcist, which he claimed was the source of Anita Hill's stories about the pubic hair on the Coke can. I mean, it was pretty surreal stuff. They had, you know, alleged experts talking about that she was an erotomaniac and so on and so forth. It's worthwhile to go back and watch these when you think that, you know, the Trump show is, you know, that we've never had the kind of like lunacy in this country that we've had, you know, till now, because you see some of these people, it was pretty crazy stuff. In any event, Biden, I think, you know, the feeling was among some people at the time, and now increasingly so, really bungled the hearings, in part because he wanted to be the neutral guy. He wanted to show that he was not biased one way or the other. And the funny thing is he claimed at the time afterwards, you know, that he was sort of snookered in this by the Republicans. They didn't play fair, which always amused me because, you know, his great claim to fame is, you know, supposed to be his shrewd sense of realpolitik. And then, you know, time and time again, he's like Lucy with the football by his own admission.
He is a Democrat. He is a Democrat, after all.
Yeah. I mean, and the truth of the matter is that I think it wasn't just that he got snookered. I think he was, you know, pretty sympathetic to Clarence Thomas and pretty skeptical of Anita Hill. And a lot of people were, you know, at the time, not, you know, necessarily women. But, you know, it was she's since become a kind of much more uncontroversial figure. But at the time, you know, it was more controversial. The hearings ended, and then the vote, I think in the end, was something like 52-48. It was one of the closest votes in up until that time. I think it may have been the closest vote of any Supreme Court justice in American history.
He did not quite get borked.
No. But that was all hanging over him in the background.
Yeah. I'll let you jump in, Alexei, in a second. But one thing you say about Thomas is that he is a black nationalist, and I think that'll be a very surprising thing to hear for a lot of, you know, liberals and leftists. So could you unpack that idea? Explain in what sense he is a black nationalist.
Sure. So the first thing is that he has a past of as a black nationalist on the left. He was a campus activist at Holy Cross. He was part of a class that helped desegregate Holy Cross. He arrived there in 1968, the fall of 1968. And when he got there, you know, this is, you got to remember, this is the year that Martin Luther King is assassinated. Bobby Kennedy is assassinated. Malcolm X has already been assassinated. And so it's a moment where the black freedom struggle is kind of beginning going into despair, which continues. 1968 is the last time there's any great legislative achievement in Congress, the Fair Housing Act. And so it's a time when, and historically, it should be said, you know, black nationalism tends to thrive at moments of, you know, of moments of when white supremacy seems to be on the ascendancy, or when the freedom struggle kind of hits the wall of white supremacy. And this is definitely a moment like that. And so Thomas is a campus activist. He's the founder, one of the co-founders of the Black Student Union, and which, you know, that choice of using the word black was very significant at the time. You really were showing, it was kind of a West Coast phenomenon to start embracing that term. And it was sort of militancy. And he continues that throughout his time in college. And so my argument, and these are some biographical facts that sort of came out at the hearings, believe it or not, before the Anita Hill revelations. He was asked what he majored in, and he said English literature. He was asked what he minored in, and he said protest. And and he wasn't lying, you know, because he was quite active. And he was, you know, even amongst his sort of group of co-militants, he was thought of as, you know, really kind of race conscious in all kinds of ways. And the argument of the book is that black nationalism, and by that I mean a kind of program of mutual black solidarity that's very skeptical of integration, that's very skeptical of liberalism, it's very skeptical of the state, which it sees as an inherently white institution, and that wants to foster separate black institutions and sees that as the condition for black flourishing, really black survival first and foremost, but black flourishing maybe. All of those positions, oh, and black self-defense, I should say, have stayed with Thomas.
Yep.
on the court. And just to give you, I mean, I could give you multiple examples of this, but one, if you read his Second Amendment jurisprudence, it really is kind of fascinating. I mean, you know, there's lengthy discussions of Black Reconstruction and white terrorism in the 19th century. He quotes extensively from Herbert Aptheker's book on Black slave revolts. Herbert Aptheker was a Communist Party historian, was party to lawsuits that came to the Supreme Court, but I don't think has ever been quoted as an authority or an expert by a Supreme Court justice. Clarence Thomas does. In a more recent case, he extensively quotes from Eric Foner's book on Reconstruction. So he's really, you know, quite knowledgeable and indebted to this moment in Black history and African American politics, and sees the whole question of the right to bear arms very much through that lens of Black self-defense. And that's just, again, one example. There are many others.
It's so fascinating. Reading this great book was like drinking from a fire hydrant. It was so much to take in and process. I just there's not enough time to talk about all the interesting things that you write about and that you unearth for us. But the fact is that there seems to be this really interesting symmetry between what leftists, like the illiberalism of Clarence Thomas and the illiberalism of leftists in their critiques of the failures of liberalism. And, you know, so much of what he points to in what we might call on the left, the reformist attempts of, you know, the state to intervene and simply kind of reaffirm those inequities because of the structural problems, he ascribes to white supremacy, and he thinks it's just, you know, his race pessimism, as you show, is such that he doesn't think electoral politics or the state is a refuge to liberate. But he has, you know, such an interesting and incisive critique going back right to the founding, that not even reparations are possible because the harms are so real and persistent and perturbable. It's fascinating to see so much of his critiques as paralleling the left's, and yet the pessimism and the kind of recourse to the market is kind of the unfortunate refuge that he takes. But maybe you could talk a bit more about all that.
Sure. I mean, I think the part of the reason why you see so much resonance between some of his positions, and I should say he's still, I think, a Black nationalist, but he's a Black nationalist on the right. He's not a leftist by any stretch, and that's not the claim of the book. He's a conservative Black nationalist, of which there have been conservative Black nationalists in the past in this country. I mean, he's the first conservative Black nationalist to sit on the Supreme Court, which is just part of the innovation that needs to be dealt with here. But I think one of the reasons why you see so much resonance with some of the positions on the left is that I think both sides are living in the shadow of the same historical event, which is the defeat of the Black freedom struggle. Thomas, you know, is alert to this from a pretty early position. And struggling with it in the early 1970s, and as are a lot of other activists, Black activists. And I think the shadow of defeat really hangs over both sides in different ways, and is almost, you know, incalculable to talk about what impact that kind of the defeat of a political struggle can have, because it makes it, you know, all the things that liberals and leftists might talk about, like state action, like collective action, parties and movements and so forth, become very hard to imagine. I mean, we're still dealing with this today on the left on a whole host of issues, you know, climate change just being the most extreme instance of this, you know, just the sort of profound skepticism that we could actually do anything. And I think that really is at the heart of the matter for Thomas. And then on top of that, you know, there's this notion that part of the reason why nothing can be done is the profundity and intensity of white racism, which he sees as kind of an original sin that has no real historical source to his mind. And because it has no real historical source, it has no real historical exit either. It just becomes a kind of preternatural part of the human condition almost. And he sees it pervading particularly every active state, including, I should say, a lot of policing and prison activity as well, although he has a different attitude about that as a result. And also, so every activity of the state and every kind of political action. So when you brought up reparations, it's not just that reparations, you know, you could never make up for the harms that had been done. For Thomas, the political agents, the people who would be doing it, making up for, are white people.
That's right.
That's right.
And this is what he's constantly coming back to. I mean, his critique of affirmative action is very different from your traditional right-wing critique, because his premise is that affirmative action is essentially a program that is run by white people for the benefit of other white people. It has nothing to do with black people at all, except that they are the victims of it.
Yeah, and but it parallels the noblesse oblige that some strangely conservatives tend to like otherwise, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So and Thomas does too. He doesn't like white noblesse oblige. I think what he likes is black noblesse oblige, and so you know, he's very committed to a kind of black patriarchal vision, where a kind of black man like his grandfather, who he, you know, is a very influential figure on his political philosophy, would accumulate wealth and then through his patronage, you know, redistribute it to the black community and protect the black community from white predation. So, you know, yeah, he's a black nationalist, but he's not an egalitarian. And, you know, he's sort of the, you know, at the heart of his vision of black nationalism is this vision of black men. Where black women kind of play a subordinate role, if they play any role at all. And, you know, which, and if you go back to the whole Anita Hill thing, starts to emerge in a very different light. And his claims about high-tech lynching and so forth, which were, you know, on the one hand, there's no doubt, you know, that he did what Anita Hill said he did, and so it was guilty of those and committed perjury. At the same time, I think that that kind of rhetoric of high-tech lynching and, you know, and by the way, that wasn't just in the heat of the moment. He repeats that in his memoir, which came out in 2008. So he still believes that he compares the Democrats and liberals to the KKK and the Knights of the Camellia and so on and so forth. But I think there's a kind of genuineness to the rhetoric, which is that, you know, what white liberalism has done, the way white liberalism has worked its poison in the black community, first and foremost, is to undermine black male authority. And so Anita Hill seems to him, you know, in that moment to just be the ally of a kind of white liberalism that has been doing its harms to the black community, particularly to black men, for quite some time.
You have a very striking comparison between how people talked about Thurgood Marshall and how, you know, a lot of conservatives, they always said, oh, Thurgood Marshall's lazy, he doesn't know any law stuff, and he's just getting his clerks to write his opinions for him, he doesn't know anything about anything. And how liberals have talked about Clarence Thomas, saying similar stuff. But you, as you demonstrate in this book, Thomas has a very consistent ideology, which you can really suss out from reading his opinions and how he is, you know, talk to the news media and so forth. So can you like draw that out for us? Like, what is his basic ideology about, you know, politics, economics, and so on?
Well, first, let me just say one thing about Thurgood Marshall. It wasn't just conservatives who said these things about him. It was also liberals. I mean, Archibald Cox, who was the, you know, special prosecutor during Watergate, who was fired by Richard Nixon on the Saturday Night Massacre, was a, you know, legendary solicitor general under, I think, Kennedy or Johnson. Real liberal hero, Archibald Cox. He said that Thurgood Marshall, this is what he said about Marshall. He may not be very bright or hardworking, but he deserves credit for picking the very best law clerks in town. You know, this is, you know, again, Harvard law professor. This is not a right winger who's saying this. Bob Woodward, in his book The Brethren, you know, claimed that that with Thurgood Marshall spent his day watching television, and that what he was really, the reason why people liked him on the court was he told good dirty jokes. not his opinion. So this was also a kind of liberal suspicion, which, you know, again, people forget. And it's just striking when you look at all the claims against Thomas. They line up almost, you know, word for word. It's very similar to what was said about Thurgood Marshall on the part of kind of white liberals and conservatives. But in terms of Thomas, I've been working on this book for quite some time, and I would say the hardest thing to try to convince people of when I'm talking about this book is that Clarence Thomas, you know, has a mind and has a jurisprudence of his own. And both conservatives and liberals and leftists, everybody, you know, thinks, you know, he got, you know, all of his ideas from Scalia. The evidence in many cases indicates exactly the opposite. Scalia got them from him, and he broke with Scalia on, you know.
Makes you more sympathetic to Thomas's race pessimism, doesn't it?
Well, that's the, you know, yeah. I mean, the irony is that when he says, you know, affirmative action taints all black people with this kind of stigma of inadequacy. And, you know, I mean, I've been working on this book for some time, and, you know, I get a lot of, you know, well-meaning liberals and leftists, I should say, who get on and like, well, you know, he was an affirmative action, this, that, and the other. And it's like, you're kind of proving his point. You know, and you know, and people are shocked when I tell them he has written over 700 opinions. You know, there's so much kind of, you know, why doesn't he talk? Why doesn't he speak? And it's like, well, if you want to hear what he has to say, it's kind of easy, you know, to find, like, this wasn't some kind of deep dive I did, like, you know, and had to go into these archives that nobody had ever looked at. I mean, well, I think I actually did look at some of the things nobody ever looked at with Supreme Court opinions. But in any event, so that's a long wind up. Sorry, Ryan, to your question. Yeah, so what is his philosophy? I think, you know, the book is divided into three parts: race, capitalism, and constitution. So the first thing I start with is I think the foundation of his entire political vision has to do with race. And his belief that racism is a kind of incurable condition, that it is everywhere. You know, people have oftentimes misread him as a kind of colorblind thinker, which is, you know, very far from the truth. That is not the way he sees the world. He's, you know, highly race conscious. He and not just that it's everywhere. It's in places that both liberals and conservatives never want to talk about. So he has a whole reading of, and I won't get into the specifics, of campaign finance jurisprudence, where, you know, he tries to show how the roots of campaign finance, and specifically the desire to restrict corporate spending, are rooted in kind of white supremacist backlash against Reconstruction. So, you know, it's everywhere, racism. So that's the kind of foundational premise of his jurisprudence. And then, that it infects all acts of state. So any kind of liberal intervention through the state, for the sake of African-American equality, will only reinforce African-American inequality and subjugation. And so politics in the state are kind of no-go territory. And I think that it really, if you look at his voting rights jurisprudence, which people, you know, liberals have a very hard time making sense of, I think it's actually not that complicated. He really does believe black people shouldn't be voting. It's that simple. and would like them to devote their efforts elsewhere.
But it's really interesting why, because he thinks that voting isn't something that can liberate black people, because the white supremacy that's inherent in the electoral system, that's inherent in our governments, won't permit it, right? And so like, find liberation elsewhere.
Exactly. I mean, I think he doesn't quite believe in liberation, so I don't want to go too far.
Right.
Right. He is a conservative.
Individual flourishings, perhaps, right?
Like, I don't think it's either individual. He does have a collective vision. He's not an individualist. He's not a kind of libertarian in that sense.
Would you say Burkean, because he believes in communities and kind of the tradition that passes on from this embeddedness in family and community? Is that something that you think he's...
Well, he doesn't believe it passes on necessarily. And I mean, I have a different read on Burke, which I won't get into here today.
Right.
Yeah. But it's a I think it's kind of a patriarchal vision. It's that, right. You know, black men are the kind of foundation of protection for the Black community against white people. And that's where he comes to his kind of emphasis on Black capitalism.
And the market can do that for Black men, right?
And the market. Yeah, exactly. And so that's the second. So I have a whole reading of things like his takings clause jurisprudence, his commerce clause jurisprudence, his equal protection jurisprudence, commercial speech, which is about speech that's used in the marketplace, where he's really out there in a lot of these things. And the whole point is to kind of find niches for Black capitalism, which he thinks is, you know, the best that can be hoped for. So that's, I think the second part is, you know, the first part is race. The second part is this critique of politics in the state and the embrace of the market. And then the last part is his constitutional vision. He's kind of an originalist. I don't, you know, put too much stock in that. But what's weird about his originalism is that he has two different ideas of the Constitution. Most originalists, self-proclaimed conservative originalists, you know, kind of look back to the Constitution that was ratified in 1787 and ratified in 1789, you know, the kind of the original white man's Constitution. And Thomas recurs to that and will acknowledge that it's a white Constitution, but it's also very indebted to the Constitution that was revolutionized during the Civil War and Reconstruction, which I call the Black Constitution. And so he has these two different ideas. But just very quickly, I think what's interesting about, you know, you'd say this, you might think, you know, you'd say to him, well, if you think America and the government and everything is so imbued with white supremacy, why would you want to recur to either the original Constitution or even the Constitution of the 19th century? And I think there's actually a pretty straightforward answer that he's given to that, which is that he thinks Black people, particularly Black men, flourished the most under Jim Crow. He's a real believer in adversity, you know, freedom through adversity. Wow is right. And it's not that he wants to recreate slavery or Jim Crow, but he does want to find a way of recreating the Black institutions that were created under those conditions. Because he thinks that was, you know, the American Black African American Renaissance.
It's almost Darwinian, isn't it?
Yeah, except there's no notion of kind of constant evolution it's pretty static. You know, Darwinism is a pretty dynamic vision, I would say. You know, but it is Darwinian in the sense that he believes that, you know, conditions of, you know, really deep constraint and adversity, you know, force, you know, the kind of the strongest to rise to the occasion. And that's what he wants to create. And he says, you know, it's true, I want to go backward. He says this at one point, but because I feel like that's the key to the Black future, essentially, is to go backward in time. You know, and that's really, you know, kind of straight out, in some ways, straight out of the conservative playbook. It's, you know, it's what's called reactionary modernism. But.
Right. And you've talked about Nietzsche and Hayek together in terms of how conservatism kind of draws on both thinkers. And in your work on freedom, you wrote about kind of the left versus the right in the politics of freedom. It's kind of Karl Polanyi versus Hayek. Would you say that Clarence Thomas fits into choosing the side of Hayek? And is there who are the thinkers that you think help explain theoretically the way that he orients himself?
Well, Hayek definitely is one thinker, and I use some of the stuff on Hayek in one of my chapters, particularly on stuff on speech and money. You know, the First Amendment kind of stuff. So I think Hayek is, you know, I think that, you know, his favorite novelists, you know, is Richard Wright, one of his favorites. And I think that was, you know, Native Son is a kind of recurring theme in his sort of autobiography, and I think had a big influence on him. Malcolm X, believe it or not, is another influence. You know, Juan Williams wrote this amazing profile of him back in 1987 in The Atlantic, back when Williams was a, you know, actually a good journalist. And, And, you know, Thomas could recite for him, you know, various speeches from Malcolm X from memory. You know, he had records in college that he had of Malcolm X's speeches, you know, and would listen to them. And, you know, throughout the 80s, when he's in the Reagan administration, he's quoting Malcolm X against liberals and saying, you know, you guys want to invoke Malcolm X. And by the way, he's a, you know, huge fan of that, the Spike Lee film on Malcolm X. He's a big fan of Spike Lee in general, actually.
Right. Didn't you describe his Black Constitution at some point as Mad Max combined with Do the Right Thing?
Yes, it's true. I mean, you know, and you should, again, you should read these Second Amendment opinions of his. I mean, they're really blood curdling. Just the centrality of Black violence as, I mean, it almost parts, I mean, it'd be too strong to say it reads like, you know, it's kind of reads like vulgar Franz Fanon. He talks about the kind of sense of emancipation that Black men felt from the ability to wield weapons of violence against their white tormentors. And he uses, I think, I'd have to go back and double check, but he uses that language of a sense of freedom or sense of emancipation that they felt. So, you know, I wouldn't say, you know, I don't want to make any great claims for Thomas as being like, you know, I wouldn't put him in the canon of, you know, great African-American or American political thinkers. But, you know, he is a Supreme Court justice and has developed a very distinctive body of jurisprudence in which some of these themes that you do see in the Black nationalist canon and the African-American canon. I mean, there's all, and I do readings in the book comparing some of the stuff you see from Stokely Carmichael in Black Power and Charles Hamilton in Black Power, Marcus Garvey. There's some Du Boisian moments. So there's just, you know, there's an awful lot of kind of resonance in his work. And, if, you know, again, you know, people on the left never read him, so they wouldn't see it. And people on the right, you know, don't really know about this kind of stuff, so they don't see it for the most part either. So it's, you know, it's been the, it's probably the strangest book I've ever written, because everything I'm saying is, once you start reading, it's so obvious. You wonder how in the hell has nobody done this before? So it's been a strange trip writing it.
I bet. I imagine.
This, thinking about, I'm just trying to get my head into the space of Clarence Thomas. You know, you talk about how Murray Rothbard was a big fan of Black nationalism, and he was one of the people, you know, setting up an alliance between libertarians and like Pat Buchanan and Ron Paul, you know, trying to fuse libertarians with basic like white nationalists, basically, and an alliance that's shown a lot of fruit, and you know, being Clarence Thomas and seeing people like that guy praising your political orientation while the vast majority of the Black population is going in the other direction, it just must be some kind of incredible cognitive dissonance or something, or just, I don't know, isolation or whatever you might call it. How do you think he kind of deals with that?
Yeah, it's a great question. I mean, the first thing I should say is, you know, in a weird way, there's kind of a history to this. Well, before I get into the history, I think, and Thomas has said this from very early in his right turn, that he would rather deal with a kind of outright bigot who's honest to your face and openly expresses his contempt and his racism, rather than the kind of white person who, you know, proffers all sorts of liberal, you know, racial platitudes, but is, you know, secretly harboring all kinds of racist thoughts. And, you know, his favorite song in the early 70s was the song Smiling Faces Tell Lies. The Undisputed Truth, I think, was the band. You know, that's the song, and, you know, Smiling Faces Tell Lies. They don't tell the truth. And, you know, that for him was kind of a mantra of what the problem was with white liberals and white leftists. And, you know, he has in his memoir, he has language about, you know, the rattlesnake versus the cottonmouth. You know, I think it's the cottonmouth snake. I don't know my snakes, but, you know, at least the rattlesnake, I remember this, the rattlesnake is open and, you know, announces his lethality and doesn't, you know, hide it. And if you look, I mean, and he has that, you look, the syntax and the kind of animalistic imagery is word for word almost what Malcolm X says about, you know, kind of, I think foxes and wolves or lions and foxes, I can't remember. It's the same kind of contrast that he draws. And there's a long lineage of this. You know, Marcus Garvey, you know, said that the, you know, the good thing about the Klan is at least they're honest with, you know where you stand with them. And you know, in some ways they're, you know, kind of a better friend to the black man. So I think this idea of racial, I mean, and I talk about this in the book, racial sincerity versus insincerity is really foundational to him. And is why I think, you know, wouldn't have, you know, and so, you know, you have Garvey and the Klan, you have the Nation of Islam and the American, you know, the American Nazi Party comes to their rallies in the early 60s. There's been this kind of long sort of fraternity between certain kinds of black nationalism and, you know, white racism and white nationalism. And I think Thomas sort of comes out of that tradition. So that's the first part of that, the answer to your question. But secondly, he's quite aware that how much the black community disagrees with him and loathes him. And, you know, I think he sees himself as a kind of, you know, prophetic figure who is sort of laying down the foundations for a vision that he understands most black people are currently not going to embrace, but one day will come to see the truth of what he has to say. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I would imagine he looks at conditions as, you know, that are this is pure speculation and, you know, take it for what it's worth, but, you know, sees the way things are going, racial lines getting hardened and hardened. Colorblindness, you know, the Republicans used to pretend to be colorblind. They don't do that anymore. And, you know, in a way, it's kind of everything's going his way. You know, this is the reality of what politics is about. You know, condition for black people has been worsening over the years. And, you know, he thinks, you know, it shouldn't depend on white people.
You know, the Clarence Thomas book is rich and interesting for a number of reasons, but one of them I think is tied to this leftist project we started out talking about in terms of the theoretical way forward, because you suggest that understanding Clarence Thomas is a form of understanding something that's emblematic of how we need to see both the past and the future, and that you say that it's not the task at hand. The task at hand isn't to retrace and rebut his moves from premise to conclusion, but to go back and start again with different premises, perhaps because he has hit upon in some of his illiberal critiques things that are really true. But we need to kind of find a way to take those truths and move in a different direction. What did you have in mind there in terms of talking about how emblematic this study of Clarence Thomas might be for the left?
Yeah, I mean, I think the first thing is his sense of racism as a kind of sort of the autonomous life of racism, that it has a kind of depth and life of its own that can't really be rooted in things like politics, or that it's endogenous to politics and economics, and that he, you know, ultimately, I think it's kind of, you know, mostly a sort of psychological, psychocultural explanation. And so I think that's the first thing. I think if you don't have a political account of racism, and I don't mean an account that explains how racism gets used, because that still acts as if racism is this sort of thing that's just this natural ingredient, that then gets manipulated and deployed by politicians. And I mean something more than that. So if you don't have a real political historical account of racism, I think that's, you know, problem number one. Number two, I think, is this notion that both the state and politics are kind of helpless in the face of white supremacy, that white supremacy is such a kind of ontological fact, deep ontological truth of American social life, that politics and government are kind of helpless before it. And then the third is the idea of that there being alliances between people who have, you know, are of different, radically different situations and histories and memories, you know, which Thomas thinks is just, you know, impossible. And I think really those three assumptions, I don't think are peculiar to him. I think they kind of transcend and, you know, kind of go across the political spectrum. And I think they have to be interrogated, you know, and I wouldn't want to say much more than that. You'll be pleased to know so we can go. Because, you know, I don't have the 10-point program as the alternative. But I the point is that I to try to get people on the left and liberals to see just, you know, in some ways, what an eerily familiar voice this is that we have not been listening to this entire time. Maybe because it is so familiar.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Thanks very much, Corey.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks for coming on. And yeah, book's coming out in September. We'll link it in the description. And yeah, definitely check that one out. It's going to be good.
Absolutely. Pre-order it now. The Enigma of Clarence Thomas.
Thanks a lot.
All right. Take care.
Last but not least, we have a friendly reminder that we have a Patreon. You can support the show with $5 a month and get an extra episode every week. We really appreciate the support, and it helps us keep this going.
Of the evil that lurks within. Smiling faces, sometimes they don't tell the truth. Smiling faces, tell lies, and I got